Again, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
If we reflect upon the early doctrinal disputes in the church, find that they all focus on how the three persons of the Trinity relate to each other. For example, the first one, we call Nestorianism, whether Mary would be called Theotokos rather than Theopriestos. In other words, was Jesus really God, truly God, truly divine, and sharing life in the Trinity? And then we run into monophysitism. Was Jesus also truly man? Even the 11th century this doctrinal view of filioque, which, by the way, is not so much on the substance of filioque as the pretensions of the Roman pontiff to declare it, to change a symbol of faith. And even that is, again, how the Trinity is relating to each other. Now, we have come, Catholic faith is that God is one, and that there is a communal. And communal, for me, is kind of a difficult word, in the fellowship of three persons. Now, why am I talking about that here and now in Gethsemani? If you look at the Gospel of John, the Gospel of John says Jesus was praying, perhaps in the upper room, perhaps somewhere there, before he came to the Kidron Valley, across the Kidron Valley, and came here, where there was a garden, so it said. That prayer is most significant, because that prayer, the priestly prayer of Jesus, allows us to see God at prayer. What other religion has God praying for his people? Now, that's amazing in itself, that God is praying for us, that in the life of the Trinity, we're getting a little glimpse of that relationship of Father and Son, what they're saying to each other, what Jesus, true God and true man, is saying to God the Father. And what's he talking about? When Jesus had his last earthly life on earth, what was he talking about? Our unity. Let's think first of all about the unity of churches. Now, all of you were born after Vatican II. So this relationship between the churches, the cordial relationship that for the most part exists, is kind of, for you, normal. That's the way things are. When the Protestants or the Orthodox have a prayer service, we go. Brothers, before Vatican II, I'll give you an example. In the 1940s, I think 42, the head of the Jesuits, Superior General, was formally censured by the Holy See. Do you know why? He was so daring as to pray an Our Father in public with an Orthodox bishop. How dare he pray with heretics? So we have come a long way in 50 years. I tell people to be patient because this has been a state of division for millennia. It's going to take a little bit of time to heal the wounds. Doctrinally, we can work through all that. We now have to establish bonds of love and trust. Now, secondly, we can leave the matter of unity to the popes, the patriarchs, and bishops. But what about the unity among ourselves? How often do we ever confess sins against the unity of our community? How often do we say, I disrupted the serenity of the house, or I made this one an enemy of this one, or not talking to this one? Think about the sins against unity. What are we doing to promote the unity of our communities? I'll give you one example in style. There was one parish that was having a parish summer festival. Well, in the committee, this one was arguing with this one. This one wanted to do that, that one wanted to do this, and they were going on and on about it. I said that such an endeavor, which could make thousands of dollars for the parish, was too dangerous, because it was much more important that Mary be friends with Paula than the church have thousands of dollars. So I just canceled the festival. Why? What could I base that? Jesus, in his last prayer, prayed that we stay